Gaskins. She told me to say a little bit about myself. I hope that's okay. I preach at my church, Fairview Church of Christ in Oxford, Alabama. So I'll try my best not to preach at you this morning. And I have a lot of passion about this subject. I have a lot of interest in things that are written down in this text for obvious reasons. And some of you, you may not be that way, or you may be. That is up to you. But this morning, what I want to look at is the Pharaoh's heart. And with the heart there isn't actually about the literal heart. It's the metaphorical heart. It's talking about your essence, or the Hebrew word for heart, I think, is translated as the seat of passions. So it's about where your emotions come from. It's sort of what drives your decisions and everything. And this topic is actually has some controversial nature to it. I know that in the past I've been asked questions about it from a theological standpoint. And then there's also, even if you're just looking at it from a literary standpoint, there's some interesting points of view in here just looking at the protagonist or God in the story. So just to give a little bit of a background story, we have the Israelites, which are in the story God's people. They have been enslaved in Egypt for hundreds of years, okay? They have been forced to do tasks. They've pretty much been whipped and beaten and just oppressed terribly. Okay, then God chooses Moses, who has been in Pharaoh's court, and then he ended up killing an Egyptian and running away. And then most of you probably know the story of Moses with the burning bush on fire. And so God spoke to Moses, told him to go talk to the Pharaoh. And then there's also Aaron that goes with them, and he's chosen to speak to the Pharaoh about letting the Israelites go. And that's the whole mission when speaking to the Pharaoh. Let the Israelites go. That's his message. But the Pharaoh's heart is hardened, and he refuses to let them go over and over again. Sometimes he gives a little bit of leeway and says, oh, how about this? But then he ends up taking it away. His heart is continually hardened. And then this leads to the Egyptians and the Pharaoh's demise via God's wrath. Okay, so what about this? What makes this so big of a deal? In Exodus 7:3, when God is telling Moses to go speak to the Pharaoh, he says, "But I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and though I multiply my signs and wonders in the land of Egypt." Okay, so God is saying that he's going to harden the Pharaoh's heart. So the big question comes up here is, did God take away the Pharaoh's free will? Did he just steal it from him? Whether this is subjectively or objectively, steal the Pharaoh's free will away from him and force his heart to harden so that he would not let them go. Okay? And so this is the big question. This is what we want to think about this morning. And then there's three different ways that it says that Pharaoh's heart was hardened. And that's what I want to look at first. In Exodus chapter 8, verse 15, it says, "But when Pharaoh saw that there was respite, he hardened his heart and would not listen to them as the Lord had said." The antecedent of he being the Pharaoh, not the Lord. Okay, so it says here that the Pharaoh hardened his own heart. And this is what God had said. When before we saw, "But I will harden the Pharaoh's heart." Okay? And then next we have, "Still Pharaoh's heart was hardened, and he would not listen to them as the Lord had said." This has no origin of the hardening. It just says that his heart was hardened. And again, we see that it says this is what God had said. And then last, we have what we read earlier. "But the Lord hardened the heart of the Pharaoh, and he did not listen to them as the Lord had spoken to Moses." Okay, so now we see here, God hardened the Pharaoh's heart just as he had said he would. So we have three cases here. Okay, God said he would harden Pharaoh's heart, but then we see Pharaoh hardened his own heart. We see his heart was just hardened. It has no specific origin. And then we see that his heart was hardened by God. And then, what's with this? Is this a contradiction? Or are all three the right answer? Or are all three meaning the same exact thing? Well, through some research, through some looking into the subject, you can, I would say there's two different ways of going about and researching this. One is if you look at the Bible as this whole unit of knowledge where one thing kind of points back to the next. Sort of like I look at it, for me, I'm a math major. I sort of look at it like as a law, okay? And where one theorem kind of points to another, and one theorem backs up another, and then another definition helps this this theorem make sense, and then you have this theorem which gives way to a corollary, and so on and so forth. And so I sort of look at it like that, where one thing can help you understand another thing in the Bible if you're not really understanding what's going on. And so one comes from this big long text I have written here in Romans 9, 17 through 24. I'm going to read it real quick. For the scripture says to Pharaoh, "For this very purpose I have raised you up, that I might show my power in you, and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. So then he has mercy on whoever he wills, and he hardens whomever he wills. You will say to me then, why does he still find fault? For who can resist his will? But who are you, O man, to answer back to God? Will what is molded say to the molder, why have you made me like this? Has the potter no right over the clay to make out of the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another for dishonorable use? What if God desiring to show his wrath to make known his power, has endured with much patience vessels of wrath prepared for destruction, in order to make known the riches of his glory for vessels of mercy, which he has prepared beforehand for glory, even us whom he has called, not from the Jews only, but also from the Gentiles." Okay, so this whole thing, as we can see, it does go back and it talks about the Pharaoh, but it also has this whole thing about the pottery and stuff like that. And what this is actually referring back to is specifically in Jeremiah chapter 18, verses 1 through 10. And then all of these actually kind of go back and point to this idea that I have highlighted in blue in the front. So then he has mercy on whom he wills, and he hardens whomever he wills. Okay, so he gives mercy to who he wants, he hardens whomever he wants, and these Jeremiah 18, 1 through 10 sort of gives some, kind of enlightens us on this hardening and on this mercy. And then so do these verses as well. They all kind of point back to this subject, and they all kind of give a deeper understanding and a better understanding of what's going on. And what it really conveys is that all three of those are one. That when God said that he was going to harden the Pharaoh's heart, what that meant was that he was going to harden his heart, and the Pharaoh was going to harden his heart, and just the heart hardening in general. That it meant all three in one. And it does so because I will make the point that Romans 9, 17 through 24 still kind of lends itself to a deterministic point of view where, you know, even though he didn't subjectively take away his free will, there's still an objective sense of, well, he kind of gave the occasion for it. Okay, but all three of these do kind of convey the idea that the Pharaoh really did harden his own heart, and that's the same thing as God doing it and it happening in general. Okay. And St. Augustine kind of comments on this where he says, "God does not harden men by infusing malice into them, but by not imparting mercy to them." And then another, "God does not work this hardness of heart in man, but he may be said to harden him whom he refuses to soften, to blind him whom he refuses to enlighten, and to repel whom he refuses to call." So the whole idea with the pottery and the whole idea with this is the fact that it's sort of like God sitting here sort of putting some pressure on the Pharaoh. He's trying to force him to follow his will. He's not going to literally force him, but he's trying to push him in that direction. But if he keeps on resisting, just as if like with a piece of pottery kept on resisting your will to mold, you would just give up and let it do its own thing. And that's exactly what this is saying, that he's refusing to soften. He's refusing to push him in the direction that he's refusing. God is refusing to keep on pushing him in the direction that the Pharaoh is refusing to go. There's also some Hebrew language stuff going on in here for any of you Hebrew scholars. These two ideas, they don't exactly go hand in hand, but it's just two different ideas that can work for this particular saying God hardened Pharaoh's hearts. And one is the use of an idiomatic verb in the Hebrew text, which is not the doing of a thing, but a permitting in this case. That it is not that God did it to him, but he permitted it. An idiomatic verb, one that we might would use today, is I go out with Jesse McCorkle. Now that doesn't, I go out with her. Now y'all know that that means that she's my girlfriend, that I'm in a relationship with her. But the saying, I go out with her, I don't literally go out with her, like go outside all the time. She lives in Texas, I'm definitely not always going out with her or anything, but it's just an idiomatic verb, it's just a saying that means I'm in a relationship. And then this hard to pronounce for me anyways word, metonymy, is basically one word being employed for another, and it's really similar to metaphor, sort of like saying, I read Shakespeare, or I'm going to give you a hand. You're not actually going to give someone a hand. You're not going to chop your hand off, but you're going to help them out, and that's what that means. Okay, and then this is basically saying that when God said that he was going to harden Pharaoh's heart, when it said that he did, he was just giving an occasion to it. He was giving the occasion. He was giving rise to the occasion. Sort of like my father has said that, when I was younger, he made me mad by making me go talk to old people. He didn't really make me mad. He gave me occasion to, because I didn't want to go talk to old people. Same sort of deal, I suppose. Now, that's all I really have for the subject. There's many different things to look at, several different Hebrew language stuff to look at. It's pretty vast. No one's really a Hebrew scholar. But there's a strong possibility that all three explanations are one. There's no direct stealing of the, in my opinion, from what I've researched, there's no direct stealing of his subject to free will. But there is one question that can be still considered, and that is, did he objectively take away the free will? Did he, from a deterministic point of view, that he just sort of set him up for it and by laws of nature pretty much make it to where he was going to make that decision. Those are my ideas this morning. I was also told to ask if anyone had any questions, you may ask them.
I have one for you.
Okay.
From a literary perspective, why do you think it's kind of important to consider the motivation of the protagonist and with all of them, I mean, not just Pharaoh as kind of a more diminutive antagonist, but why, when we study it as literature, why are we trying to consider, do you think, the motives of the big force of good and some of the smaller forces of evil?
Well, it possibly could go back to your characterization of the protagonist and how you view the protagonist, and if you view him as this really good guy, then you're going to see something, depending on how you look at this, that he's not really all that good. Or if you could look at it the same way I'm looking at, that he is still good. Okay, and then you also, it would lend itself to, you know, the characterization that we see in other places, that he never changes, that his character is always the same. So from a literary standpoint, you say, well, is this some sort of change in character that we're seeing here? So that would be a literary view.
I was wondering this, and then her question made me want to ask you. Obviously, you have a personal spiritual purpose for reading this text. Has studying the Bible as literature changed your perspective or helped you in any way to approach the text in new ways?
It has really helped to look at it from a cultural standpoint. It is very difficult to take yourself out of your 21st century mind and jump back 5,000 years or whatever. It's really difficult to do that. So taking it, this class, from a literary standpoint has helped me to sort of take myself out of my own shoes and put myself back in that historical setting.
I think that's all the time we have. Let's thank our speaker.